Hi, my name is Bethany, and today I want to talk to you about something called prosopagnosia, or face blindness. Thank you to my patrons for voting on this topic. So this is something that I've been interested in for a while, actually. I think I first came across the actual name prosopagnosia before on Twitter or something. When I clicked on that link, I realized all of a sudden that this really explained something that I thought was odd that no one else seemed to relate to in my small circle at the time of people who were also autistic. Please note that I do not have a diagnosis for prosopagnosia. I do believe I have a very mild form of it, but I don't think it's really relevant for me to try to go get a diagnosis for it. There's not a cure or anything to really help it. It's just a thing. I don't think that it impairs me any more than it kind of contributes to awkward moments within autism, kind of social awkward settings and stuff like that. So I really don't think it's worth me trying to find out for sure. But I do experience some of these symptoms. Just wanted to let you know for clarity's sake. Now, when I had first heard of face blindness at all, it was actually through a segment on the news. They had a lady who always watched their news channel or whatever specifically for this one guy, but she was face blind, and she was so face blind where she wouldn't recognize her family members, friends, strangers, everybody. And even though she watched every single day, they had him meet her and she couldn't recognize him. And so of course I was like, that is definitely not something that I deal with. But just like with autism, that is a more severe case, and autism, face blindness, all these sorts of things have different ways they can affect you. So today we're going to learn a little bit more about face blindness or prosopagnosia together and why it might be quite relevant to autism, actually. So the most concise and useful definition I found was on the National Institute of Health's website. Prosopagnosia is a neurological disorder characterized by the inability to recognize faces. Prosopagnosia is also known as face blindness or facial agnosia. The term prosopagnosia comes from the Greek words for face and lack of knowledge. Depending on the degree of impairment, some people with prosopagnosia may only have difficulty recognizing a familiar face. Others will be unable to discriminate between unknown faces, while still others may not even be able to distinguish a face as being different from an object. Some people with the disorder are unable to recognize their own face. Prosopagnosia is not related to memory dysfunction, memory loss, impaired vision, or learning disabilities. Prosopagnosia is thought to be the result of abnormalities, damage, or impairment in the right fusiform gyrus, a fold in the brain that appears to coordinate the neural systems that control facial perception and memory. Prosopagnosia can result from stroke, traumatic brain injury, or certain neurodegenerative diseases. In some cases, it is a congenital disorder, present at birth in the absence of any brain damage. Congenital prosopagnosia appears to run in families, which makes it likely to be the result of a genetic mutation or deletion. Some degree of prosopagnosia is often present in children with autism and Asperger's syndrome and may be the cause of their impaired social development. We see here that prosopagnosia or face blindness can manifest in different ways or be different in maybe severity. We see that it is also often congenital, which is often called developmental prosopagnosia or DP, but it can be acquired. Some other sources do say that acquired prosopagnosia is pretty rare. There also seems to be some kind of connection to autism. So some signs of prosopagnosia that one of these sources listed seemed almost kind of eerily similar to some of the signs of autism in children. So things like not following someone's gaze or being unable to recognize facial expressions and avoiding social situations are all on the list for things to look out for in the case of prosopagnosia. Healthline says that if your child has face blindness, they may wait for you to wave before they come over when you're picking them up from school or an event, approach strangers thinking they're you or someone they know when they're supposed to go to a specific person, not recognize familiar people like neighbors, close relatives, or family friends, especially when they seem out of context, become clingy or withdrawn in public places, have difficulty following plots of characters in movies or TV shows, have difficulty making friends, and seem withdrawn at school but confident at home. So it is definitely possible that prosopagnosia may be contributing to some of the negative effects of having autism in some of these children, or of course later on adults' lives. I especially think of a lot of the children who are considered to be more severely autistic or have higher support needs, who don't seem to look into people's faces at all and won't really communicate why, but you don't really have much of an ability to kind of test if they are recognizing faces to the extent that other people might be. So if they have pretty significant developmental prognosia, what's the point of looking in your face when it doesn't actually give them information that they need? Maybe they're looking for your hair or your clothes or the way you smell or the words you say. There might be something else that's causing the recognition for them, so your face isn't that useful to them anyway, and it's not that they don't love you. It's just possible that some of these children do have prosopagnosia. Of course, those who do have developmental prosopagnosia or DP tend to not know that they have it because, of course, they were born that way and they never realize that other people are able to recognize better and just inherently do that. They didn't just suddenly lose the ability, so it doesn't seem that apparent. So here's the aspects that I experience that lead me to believe that I experience a very mild form of it. When I'm around friends and family often, that's fine. I don't usually have a problem recognizing people. It's weird, I just realized this as I'm recording, sorry. I realize that when I'm around people a whole lot, like my family, I don't look into someone's face to look at pieces of their face to understand who they are. I just look at their face and know who they are. I just realized that that's probably what other people do. Is that what you do? I'm not kidding you. Is that you just look at someone's face and know that that's them? That's really weird. Anyway, sorry. Sometimes I realize that I'm like, I don't know, like I'm looking at you, but I'm not seeing you. And maybe it's that I'm not trying to piece together their face because I don't need to. That's weird. Anyway, people I haven't been around in a while, like if I had been around them a lot and then I wasn't around them, or just, I guess there's been a gap of time or anything like that, I tend to have to piece the most prominent features of your face together to be sure that that's you. But for me, the best thing is your voice. So if I hear your voice, I can be much more assured that you are you and I'm not trying to have a conversation with a stranger. A lot of times when people haven't been around for a while and they like, oh, hi, and blah, 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 I feel really hesitant. I don't want to engage too much because I don't really know who I'm talking to. There are people I often rely on, like, their posture and how they hold themselves. There's one person who has a very significant jawline, the way that is. I have a friend who, their cheek right here, does this thing when they talk near their eye, and I would stare at that to be sure that that was them. But unlike a lot of people who apparently use clothes and hair to identify people, I don't think I really pay attention to that a whole lot. So I think it's interesting, but at the same time, when someone changes their hair, it feels like something, it's not like I'm like, oh, your hair is different. It takes me a minute. It's you. I hear your voice. I see most of your identifying features, but something is making my brain confused. But I think that's for everybody, right? If someone changes something. But there are people who, if you change your hair, you change your clothes or whatever, they might not be able to recognize who you are and be completely lost. There was actually one incident where someone was coming at me and I could see their face, but it wasn't clicking in my brain who they were. And they were walking differently than they normally do, I think, or something. I don't know. Maybe I just don't normally see them. I don't notice their gait as much as I do some other people's. And they were coming towards me and I had some sort of rod of some kind for something we were doing outside. And I'm so glad they spoke because they started getting a little too close to me for me to not understand why this person was coming directly at me. And thankfully they said words out loud, and then I was like, oh, that is a friendly person. I know who you are. It was just one of those moments where I was like, oh yeah, that's not good. I had no idea who you were for a minute. So yeah, I really rely on piecing significant parts of people's faces together, even how they smell, like maybe what cologne or perfume or whatever they wear, or just how they smell in general. Sometimes people have a specific smell. I thought that was interesting too, was if I'm not expecting to see the person. I remember at the time when I was younger, I had a favorite aunt, and she had come to visit me, well, my family, but it felt like me because they actually picked me up from school, and usually I was a bus rider, and they picked me up, and she was there, and I'm staring at her. And so I felt bad. I was like, yay, and I'm like kind of going toward my mom, but I'm trying to understand how, I think this is my mom. My mom's not normally in my school. Okay, that's mom. I hear her say my name. Okay, that's mom. But she's with this person. My mom's like, oh, who is it? Are you so excited? Oh my gosh. And I'm like, is that aunt so-and-so? Because I didn't know for sure. It felt so bad because obviously she came to my school with my mom to surprise me that she was there. I just felt so bad because I didn't know who she was at first. So just stuff like that has thankfully not too much of an effect on me day to day. I just hesitate a little bit until someone can reveal more qualities about themselves that makes me feel like I know who they are. But I did have in middle school a girl who would always come up and talk to me, and she would talk to me in a very comfortable way, and she knew my name and everything. And I think she was in like a group or something of mine in elementary school. Not a clue who she is. Not a single clue. Not even like the slightest ring of a bell in the back of my brain to tell me who this person is. Not a clue. Didn't have the heart to tell her though, because she knew my name and she was talking to me a lot. So yeah, so that was awkward. I could see why this might be a problem for people. As for the TV show aspect, yes, I do tend to get lost, but thankfully most TV shows have a main cast of characters, and so once we kind of get those people cemented and they tend to have their own perks and roles and stuff like that, we're good. I just get lost when, say, if it's a crime show and they have a different case every time and they have different victims and suspects and stuff, I get confused about who's who or who's supposed to be doing what, because their faces don't mean a whole lot to me. It's so bad when you get two female characters with light skin with dark hair, and I'm just like, I have no idea which one of you is doing what. They can be different heights and everything. I don't understand. So a lot of times I do have to ask my husband, like, oh, is that the person from there? Is that really them still? Like, he helps me out a lot. So an article that was hosted on Science Friday made me feel really seen. There was a quote that said this: I have always believed my whole life that if I could just pay more attention, I would be better at recognizing faces. That is me. I always feel like if I could just like make this part of my brain somehow work better, I could just do it. I don't know, other people are experiencing and they can just recognize, oh, if I just pay some more attention, all these people are just paying attention to details more than me, but it's not working. It doesn't seem to change anything. And then they do elaborate a little bit more on how people do tend to deal with having face blindness. Cope: people with prosopagnosia often develop workarounds. Some might focus on a person's gait or posture or a particularly distinctive feature, which is something I kind of already mentioned from my own experience. There was a case study that they did on a person who was diagnosed with both ASD and prosopagnosia, and in that study they were going over things in the discussion part and talking about previous studies that had found that there was some sort of link or correlation between autism and prosopagnosia. The thing is, the kind of link is not clear, so we don't know if it's a causal link, if it's just it happens together, how they may or may not influence each other, that kind of thing. We just need more research to understand why this might be happening more often in autism and whether that is contributing more to people's social problems. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, go ahead and give it a like. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below if you experience any of the symptoms of face blindness or if you think I'm just crazy. I don't know, do you have the luxury of just looking at people and immediately not even looking for pieces of their face, but just looking at them and knowing who they are. That is so amazing. I don't know. Anyway, if you enjoy autism related content from me, you can hit that subscribe button. I upload to this channel every Thursday at 4 p.m. Central Standard Time.
Thank you to everyone who supports me through YouTube as channel members and my patrons through Patreon. And a special thank you to my spaz tier patron, Jesse Graves.
Thank you so much for watching. I hope you have a wonderful week, and I'll see you in my next video.